Norwegian to country. And lexical workers were very much respected, both by the academic community as well as the Georgian public at large. But in the comprehensive English Georgian dictionary, which is one of the main projects of our lexicographic center, it was a research project of the chair of English philology for more than 25 years. And I think it's also worth noting that when we started the publication of the dictionary on a letter-by-letter basis in the 1990s, the presentation of the first festival, only one letter, letter A, was attended by the intellectual elite of BC at that time. This attitude started to deteriorate after the breakup of the Soviet Union and the period of political turmoil, civil war, etc. And within 10-15 years, the interest toward lexicography started to decline. And this short period of 10-15 years proved to be enough to cause great consequences for Georgian lexicography. I want to quote an appeal of Georgian lexicographers to the Georgian government, the academic community, adopted at the first International Symposium in Lexicography, which was organized in Batumi in May 2010. The present status of the Georgian lexicography, which has a long history and rich heritage of tradition and experience, gives ground for serious concern. Regrettably, the colossal work of lexicographers remains almost totally unappreciated in present-day Georgia. According to the appeal, the decline of interest toward lexicography was caused by the following. Lexicography was not classed among academic disciplines, and consequently, lexicographic work was not considered a scholarly work in process of contests and rating assessments. Lexicographic work was not competitive in grant competitions. Salaries of lexicographers was inadequate, compelling them to earn livelihood by means of other activities. Lexicographers were not awarded academic degrees for the lexicographic products they created, and lexicography was totally excluded from the list of state priorities. Such circumstances eventually led to the shortage of qualified lexicographers working in the field, shortage of academic dictionaries, cessation of terminological work, and as a result, worsening of knowledge of foreign languages and quality of translations, and also other consequences. In July 2010, the text of the appeal was forwarded to the organizing committee of the 14th International Symposium of Eurolex held in Leeuwarden, the Netherlands. The organizers of the Batumi Symposium in Lexicography requested their European colleagues to discuss the appeal of Georgian lexicographers and express their viewpoints concerning the issues raised in it. The board of Eurolex accepted to add their voices to the appeal for the full recognition of the discipline in Georgia. On behalf of the board, President of Eurolex, Professor Jeffrey Williams, wrote a highly instructive letter addressed to the Georgian government and the academic community. Just a brief quote. Within academia, lexicography is frequently overlooked, relegated to being a mere craft rather than an academic discipline. Such a notion is misguided and dangerous. Lexicographers not only study language for what it is, the central tool for communication, but also provide the means by which a language and its underlying cultural values may be taught and given full value within society. It would be a great pity that Georgia should neglect its European roots in neglecting the necessity to promote the study of its language, and in particular the great cultural deep of the dictionary. I love this journey. Yeah, great cultural deep of the dictionary. So with these letters, we started to talk to the government, to the Ministry of Education, and I remember we were asked to provide some kind of recommendations from our European colleagues. And they said that, well, can you ask your colleagues, your European colleagues, just to say how they deal with this problem in their countries? And then I contacted Professor Carlo Marello, who started inquiring within our sphere with her colleagues, how they could help us. And then, to my great astonishment and to my great surprise, I found out that there is not a unified approach to this problem, even outside Georgia. So it's not only a Georgian problem, but a compilation of a dictionary cannot be considered in your CD to be a scholarly work. While several years ago, we had a reality at the university who is the host of this program, we had a reality that a collection of exempt tests was considered to be scholarly work in the city, but the dictionary was not. So when we discovered that the opinion about this issue is not unanimous, so we thought that this will even worsen the situation, and as I had this possibility to organize this congress, and as we were entrusted with this great honor to organize the congress of such caliber, we thought, why not raise this issue, why not discuss this issue, and have at least some kind of document for lexicographers like Georgian lexicographers back in 2010, maybe some lexicographers in some other countries who are looked down by their colleagues as inferior linguists, just to create something as our voice, as our appeal, as our resolution, that this approach is dangerous. I fully agree with Jeffrey. Because if it is not respected, if it is not appreciated, there will be less and less young people wanting to become lexicographers. And we will have the result which we have in this country. And the great consequences is not only lack of dictionaries, but also the lack of terminology and the deterioration, I want to stress this, in the quality of knowledge of foreign languages and the quality of translation. And one more thing that I want to stress is that when I started to work, not revealing my age to you, but I still have to admit that it was in the Soviet times that I started to edit the Comprehensive English-Georgian Dictionary, and it was compiled by teachers of English. By that time, I had already defended my thesis before I started, but that's why I was invited to work as an editor of this material. So I discovered that the compiled material, nearly up to 90% of this material, was absolutely inadequate. So it was not that we had to edit it, but we had to completely recompile it. And gradually we started to realize that the knowledge of English is not enough to compile a dictionary. So this came gradually, step by step, to realize what was the mistake of initial planning of this comprehensive dictionary within the university alongside with teaching. So it is dangerous, and what Jeffrey meant by this, we see the results in this country. So let's raise our voices, dear colleagues, and say what we know. Robert Vincent writes in one of his papers dedicated to the 25th anniversary of IJL, he writes that the reason that there is not unanimous approach to this is that lexicographers have to meet deadlines and they never have time to explain what they're doing. And that linguists maybe have knowledge, great knowledge of theories, but they don't know what working on a dictionary implies. And computer NICs, as he calls them, they don't know neither one nor the other. So we need to combine all three heads in order to define those lexicographers. So let's put aside for some time our projects and raise our voices in support of lexicography. And as Jeffrey said today, let's praise lexicography and ourselves for the work we do for our countries, for our cultures, and for our nations. Thank you.
Perhaps I should say, begin by referring to a very interesting distinction that Jeffrey Williams made this morning when talking about lexicography. He talked about kudos on the one hand and cash on the other. Can you hear me, by the way? Well, that's a useful distinction, and it has a lot to do with the underlying subject of the present discussion. On the one hand, we would like lexicography and lexicographers to get more kudos, that is, more general appreciation and a more ready access to promotion and various kinds of honors. But we would also hope that lexicography and perhaps lexicographers too could get some more cash, both in terms of being better paid for the work they do on dictionaries and for dictionaries themselves, especially of the academic kind that don't necessarily make a profit, to be adequately funded by public bodies. So part of our enterprise is to make a strong case for dealing the funding bodies of various kinds.
And
what I'm going to do now is present a series of what might be called free associations, relevant in one way or another to the subject at hand. One rather strong argument, I think, for raising the profile of lexicography in the academic world is a subject that I said in my Tingri talk some days ago I didn't have time to talk about, which is what linguistics owes to lexicography. In various position papers, we have been told that lexicography nowadays owes a great deal to linguistic theories of various kinds, not to mention big data and metacorpuses. True enough. But I would also like to point out that linguistics itself can learn a lot from lexicography. Here are a few things that it can learn. First of all, dictionaries have for, I don't know how many years, possibly centuries, made a very neat distinction between derivatives and inflections. Inflections of a word, you know, go, went, gone, and so on. Typical inflections. Inflections are put in the lemma, or nearly near the beginning of a dictionary entry. Derivatives are movement as opposed to movement, go, if they are listed as sub-entries, they go at the end of the dictionary entry. In this remarkable way, dictionaries have distinguished two very important categories, derivatives on the one hand and inflections on the other. One sees this very interestingly, for example, in dictionaries of Russian, where, at least in the dictionaries of Russian that I have, aspectual variants, perfectives and imperfectives, are treated as inflections, whereas other, and that is to say that go at the beginning of the dictionary entry, whereas derivatives, if listed, go at the end. Another thing which has become increasingly clear to me in the past few days, as I have heard all sorts of discussions of, in particular, bilingual dictionaries, and one thing that has struck me like a thunderbolt is how much you can learn about the structure of your own language from working on a bilingual dictionary. You will learn all sorts of distinctions that your own language makes that you never realized it made until you compared it with some other language. Likewise, you will learn about all the distinctions your language does not make, that other languages do. And it seems to me that any academic department that is at all concerned with any aspect of language could find this information of great use. Now I want to, yes, in no particular order, I would like now to discuss, another aspect in which lexicography and in particular lexicographers can be of use not only in the academic world, but to public life in general, is a field that I have had some experience of in the early part of my life, forensic lexicography and forensic dictionaries. Let me begin with forensic dictionaries. And I want, as part of a tribute to Patrick Hanks, I mention the most hated dictionary definition in the world, which I believe Patrick and others have used from time to time to show how bad dictionary definitions can be. That is, and I'm going to give it its proper name, the first sense of hotel in Webster's Third Unabridged Dictionary, which goes on and on and on and on, and the coined phrase tells us more about hotels than we want to know. Why is that definition there in such great length? Answer, because Webster's dictionary, Webster's Third anyway, probably like the Oxford English Dictionary and others, is a what you might call a dictionary of record. It can be quoted in court cases. Is, you know, the Happy Haven really a hotel, or is it a boarding house, or a bed and breakfast? the lawyers on both sides will quote dictionaries as part of their evidence. And just to set the record straight about that much maligned vote to disturb, there is sense two, which is a very short definition, which tells you more or less what everybody knows about bells, and their basis is there. But sense one, the long one, is there because Webster's third is used in court cases. And lexicographers, too, are used in court cases. I have been used in court cases. I can give you all sorts of fascinating stories. In particular, yes, I think it's all in the past, so I can reveal and I can name names. I was called on in the case of a breakfast cereal called Ready Brett. Okay? And somebody said you cannot call it Ready Brett because Ready Brett is like breakfast. Breakfast is a common noun. And you can't call a cereal Ready Breakfast. Therefore, you can't call it Ready Bread, the abbreviation. Well, I pleaded that you could, because on the basis of linguistic usage, never mind, I won the case. But the point is that lexicographers are sometimes used in court cases just as are dictionaries. So, lexicography and dictionaries are important. I come now to the interesting subject of what lexicographers actually do. One way to describe lexicography is to describe lexicography, describe dictionaries, other lexicographic reference words. Another is to begin from the lexicographer rather than dictionary and say, what do lexicographers actually do? And as it happens, the president of Euroles, in a review of a book by Bo Svensson in IJL of 2010, said the following, a warning to lexicographers working on the outskirts of the field. They will not find much on specialized lexicography. I repeat, specialized lexicography. On the making, listen carefully, on the making of telephone books, directories, or product manuals, which also, at least according to some definitions of lexicography, belong to the discipline. Now, telephone books is very interesting. I would very much like to be employed by telephone companies to deal with the really weird alphabetical ordering of telephone books. If there are any takers, you know what to find. But there is at least one very important activity that Professor Trump Jensen did not mention in his list, and that is indexing. I know a number of people who have made an excellent living, and who still do, in part or in whole, by doing indexes. One very well-known indexer, who is also a linguistic review, is David Crystal, who is proud to be an officially recognized indexer, as well as everything else. So these are important activities, important for the world, and perhaps also important for academia, conducted by lexicographers. Well, I'm getting, I suppose, to the end of my time, as so often happens, but I would like to end by suggesting that Euroles itself might pave the way by being an example of how to treat lexicography as well. Perhaps, as my colleague Charles McGregor, the auditor of Eurolex, has suggested, Eurolex might use some of its money, insofar as it has any money to spare, to provide bursaries for young lexicographers to attend conferences like this. That is one way in which we can, as it were, walk the walk as well as talk the talk. Thank you very much.
I'm going to give the floor to Rufus now, who is going to tell us about his own position with respect to lexicography, metalexicography.
Thank you very much. We heard a few minutes ago that one of our participants yesterday bought a bottle of wine, but only received the wine bottle. And I think many people buying dictionaries have had a similar experience. They bought something and the contents did not live up to their expectations. Of course, the way in which the dictionary has been planned was of such a nature that it did not present exactly what that user needed from that specific dictionary. And one of the questions put to the panel is whether lexicography is merely a craft or whether it is a scientific discipline. And I'm going to respond to that. And by doing that, I would like to take a brief, very brief historical overview regarding the development of what today can be referred to as lexicographic theory. We all know that practical lexicography is much, much older than theoretical lexicography. Theoretical lexicography is a latecomer. The earlier dictionaries, the lexicographers didn't pay any attention to the theory when they compiled them. They were good dictionaries quite often, and quite often bad dictionaries, as we still have today in any case, despite theoretical approaches. But in the 40s of the previous century, when Chagall came to the fore with his general theory of lexicography, and in 1971, when the Bible of Theoretical Lexicography, that is also Gustav's Manual of Lexicography, was published, linguists, lexicographers suddenly realized that there is something like a theoretical approach to lexicography. And in those early phases of theoretical lexicography, the focus was primarily on the linguistic contents of dictionaries. So Gustav spent more than half this book focusing on various aspects of linguistics. Lexical semantics plays a dominant role in his book. And in many papers and books published soon after 1971, we saw this linguistic focus. And this is understandable because lexicography developed from the field of linguistics, and primarily linguists that participated in this wonderful endeavor called lexicography. But in the course of time, lexicographers also realized that, you need the contents, but that contents need to be packaged. And a good dictionary needs to have certain structures. And the presentation of the data needs to be done in a very specific way. You don't want to have an approach in a dictionary. When I'm looking for something, I want to know exactly what the system of the dictionary, what the way of presentation is. And that brought the whole focus on structures to the fore, with especially Abraham's Bigger leading the way in that regard. All through this serial of phases, the user still remained ever so important. The dictionary is not compiled merely to be used as a doorstop, although it can be a very good doorstop. It has to be used, and the needs and the reference skills of the user should play a determining role. And that's why the next phase in the theoretical lexicography development was a notion on lexicographic functions. And I'm writing this dictionary so that my users can have an assistance when it comes to text perception, text production, cognitive problem. In what way do I as lexicographer respond to the needs of my users? And in that regard, it was important to realize that lexicography was no longer merely linguistics. It was something beyond linguistics. It did include linguistics, and linguistic theory will always play a dominant role in lexicography, but there was a very strong interaction with other disciplines, information science, computer science, natural language processing. And this formed the basis for lexicographers to make a scientific plan when envisaging a dictionary. Not merely sitting down on a Sunday afternoon, I don't have a dictionary on my CD, so let's compile a dictionary. And this whole idea of writing a dictionary plan is not something new. In 1747, Samuel Johnson wrote a plan of the Dictionary of the English Language, which resulted in his 1755 dictionary. We need scientific planning to produce good dictionaries. And in this regard, the user will always be at the center. Theoretical lexicography is not theory for the sake of theory. It needs to be interpreted in terms of the practice. And in this regard, it differs from many other theories.
where emerge some new style theories, very abstract theories. If a lexicographic theory or a contribution to lexicographic theory cannot be related to the practice, it doesn't really help a lot. And that's why we're planning a dictionary. Look over there. The compilation of a dictionary is more than a mere graph. You need to be quite tough to make a dictionary, but you need something more than that. You have to ask yourself a question, what do I want my user to be able to do with this dictionary? I think that's the primary question a lexicographer should put to herself. And once you have an answer to that, you actually have an answer to what the functions of the dictionary will be. Do I want my user to be able to get some cognitive information to help with text reception, to help with text reduction, with translation, with whatever? And then you have to go one step further and say, how should I go about to select the data needed to satisfy this specific function? And there your linguistic knowledge will come into play to know which linguistic data will be important. But we have to select it in terms of the lexicographic needs, not merely in terms of linguistic needs. And then that data has to go to a dictionary. And that's when the structures once again come to the fore. If I compile a dictionary for foundation phase learners, for instance, South Africa, learners in the first 3 years of school, if you compile a dictionary with these people getting a dictionary for the first time in their life, you are structuring your dictionary in a completely different way compared to a dictionary for adult users of the dictionary. You may have a lot of same data in these dictionaries, but the presentation, the structuring will be different. And that implies you need a scientific approach to the making of dictionaries. And that's where Ernest Wiegand once said lexicography is a scientific practice aimed at the production of dictionaries so that the further practice, the cultural practice of dictionary dues can come into play. So we need that scientific basis to make good dictionaries so that our users can retrieve the information they need from the data on offer in the dictionary. And therefore, it's not only a craft, it should be a scientific discipline. But looking at the whole notion of a scientific discipline, one can ask yourself the question, what makes something a scientific discipline? There are many criteria for a scientific discipline. I would like to highlight only four of them. The one is you need a clearly defined subject matter. And in lexicography, we have a clearly defined subject matter, dictionaries. Secondly, you need research outputs with regard to that subject matter. Research outputs in the form of publications in scientific journals, papers read at conferences, and we have that. Our present conference, once again, testifies in favor of this. You need a dedicated professional association. We have the Lex family and other related families participate in ensuring that lexicography can be continued as a scientific discipline. And we need academic training in a specific field of science. And we have that team and Patrick are professors in lexicography. And I don't think any university will appoint a professor in something that is not a scientific field. So lexicography is a scientific field, and one of our major assignments as lexicographers is to bring this to the attention of many people that we are dealing with scientific field and not only a hobby, albeit that lexicography is a wonderful hobby as well. And in order to enhance the quality of lexicography as a scientific discipline, we need extensive training in lexicography. And I would like to focus on that for a few minutes. Sue Atkins and Michael Rundle in their 2013 book distinguishes between training and education. And they say training is task specific. Education is more general in scope. Training is how to, education is about. On that basis, much of the lexicographic teaching worldwide up to this date has been education delivered by academics, many of them although not all linguists. Most of the training has been organized in publishing houses and delivered by dictionary editors.
We need both training and education. And training should be done, yes, on the shop floor, in the different publication houses. But training should also be done in schools, where I personally believe dictionary using skills should be a compulsory component of syllabi in the different languages. When children leave school, they should be able to use a dictionary in a successful way. And if I refer to dictionaries, I'm referring to both printed and online dictionaries in this regard. When it comes to education, what Sue Atkins is going on your calls, I think we need to go back to the distinction Hausmann made in 1989 already between user-friendliness and a dictionary culture. Hausmann said user-friendliness is lexicography adapted to society, making dictionaries that can be used by potential target users. Whereas a dictionary culture is society adapted to lexicography, getting to know the different kinds of dictionaries. And when it comes to user-friendliness, when it comes to that assignment, we have to go further than we've gone before. And we need to introduce a much more extensive training base, education base at our universities. A number of universities, and we've heard this afternoon, already offers courses in lexicography. At my own university, we have undergraduate courses, we have a master's program, a PhD program in lexicography. And one of the innovative happenings of the last few years in Europe has been the introduction of Mastery in Lexicography, EMLEX. This program is a two-year program where students enroll at one of the participating universities. There are eight participating universities, the Friedrich Alexander University in Erlangen in Germany, the University of Lorraine in Nancy in France, University of Santiago de Compostela in Spain, the Cardinal Tesper Reformed University in Budapest, the University of Mino in Portugal, the University of Silesian in Poland, University of Rome number 3, and Stellenbosch University, and then we have two associated members, the University of Hildesheim and the Institute for German Language. And these students enroll for a two-year program. The first semester they spend at their home university, getting some basic theoretical training. Then they go to one of the universities where all these students get together for the semester, and where they have 9 different components, ranging from meta-lexicography and the history of lexicography, up to computational lexicography and the planning and the making of dictionaries. So that when they leave the program, they know something about the theoretical approach, so that they can teach other people how to make dictionaries, how to teach lexicography. But in their third semester, they also do an internship, so that at the end of the program, following this module of the planning and making of a dictionary, they can be competent lexicographers that can get additional training in the publishing houses, where they eventually may find work as lexicographers. Eurodex could or should embark on supporting this kind of a program and introducing further comparable programs so that new lexicographers can be taught. And we have to bear in mind that our typical user of the future will not be a group of people sitting here. We are dealing with Generation Z, those people born in the second half of the 90s of the previous century and onwards. And Generation Z has a totally different approach to reference and to any kind of a thing in which I can find something. They are onto the mobile, and on the mobile phone they have a one-stop source where everything can be presented to them. We need to adapt our theory and our practice to meet these people so that we don't sit with a lexicographically lost generation in a few years' time. I think, yes, lexicography is a scientific practice. Lexicography needs to be presented in various ways. Training and addiction using skills, education to establish the scientific discipline of lexicography. In 1955, J.R. Hobbit said, "I know of no more enjoyable intellectual activity than working on a dictionary." And we should spread this enjoyable intellectual activity. Thank you very much.
status of lexicography. I want to say about the Soviet era that it was not all bad, because amongst other things, it produced in the old DDR, the German Democratic Republic, East Germany, the theoretically best dictionary of German that I know, the written book that Deutsche gave to Mark Strata, and which unfortunately they didn't have corpus data, so they could see what they needed to do to interpret the data, but they had no data to interpret, such as my under communism. Okay, so I'm going to argue two things. One is that lexicography can and should play a central role in teaching and research in linguistics. I'm going to argue that it should not just be a separate discipline, but it has a central role to play in linguistics and other language-related academic disciplines, such as philosophy of language, computational linguistics, foreign language teaching, translation studies, stylistics, and so on. In most places, my belief is that, or my observation is that lexicography does not have such a role. There are a few exceptions. We need to work on that. It should be at the center of linguistics. It should pay attention to the details of word use and word meaning, not just be an ancillary, supplementary subject. In addition, I think, I also think that we must guard against complacent self-congratulation. So I used to have a sign that I wanted to hang around my neck, proud to be a hack. Lexicographers were literary hacks, and I was proud not to be an academic, and I was, such is the irony of life, I now am one, I used to say, no, I'm not a linguist, I'm a lexicographer. I study words, I study meaning. My observation was in those days, and I think still in many places, it is still true that linguistics tends to neglect words and meanings, mainly because syntacticians seem to be frightened of words, and they don't know what they're going to say, and they don't know what the words are going to do. And I attribute two causes for this situation. One is that there is a huge distinction in research, in particular, between what academic research typically aims at and what lexicographers aim at. Not only do lexicographers need to churn it out and get on to the next word before the deadline expires, but typically, researchers, PhD researchers, can aim at depth, to cover in depth every aspect of some tiny subject. I'm thinking of Kingsley Amis's satire, Lucky Jim, where I think the hero is writing about a thesis on the influence of shipbuilding building in medieval trade in 1430 to 1460, and he runs out of time, so he makes it 1430 to 1450. You can't do that in lexicography. So Samuel Johnson was able to say, of this word, I know not the precise meaning. It turned out that it's probably a misreading anyway. But you can't say, of this word, I know not the precise signification in a modern dictionary. You have to pretend to be able to say something, even if you've got nothing to say. So what we're dealing with is a small, in theoretical terms, non-finite set, but it's worth emphasizing that it is non-finite, and this is the problem. And it contrasts with the very large non-finite set of the number of possible meanings that can be expressed using English words. So, I've lost one of my slides. It's a lot of Merriam-Webster there. What I also want to say is that the problem can be traced back to two sources. One is the nature of academic research, but the other is to dictionaries themselves and to false beliefs generated by existing dictionaries. And that's where I mean that we, where I say that we guard against complacent self-congratulation. There is, by the way, a printed version of this presentation, which I sent to Tina, and so you can ask me to email it to you, or you can ask Tina for a printout, perhaps, yeah, if anybody gets excited by what I'm saying. Okay, I'm going to speak very, very briefly about the damage that dictionaries have done, and of course I'm going to take Merriam-Webster because it is an easy target. It's like an elephant. It's unmissable and hugely wrong, lumbers around, causing enormous damage. Okay, here is the word school. Now, the problem with the word school is that lexicographers, especially American lexicographers, are profoundly ignorant of the basics of English grammar. And a put. I will now put the bottle. I have put the bottle. Is that a well-formed sentence of English? No. Because there is a third argument. You have to put something somewhere. American dictionaries, on which I have worked, and that was the American College Dictionary of Farnborough, 1947. I was not working on it in 1947. This is slightly before my time. They have no mechanism for recognizing the essential role of the third argument, and you only have to think of a doctor treating you and contrast it with somebody treating somebody else well to recognize the importance of that third argument. It changes the meaning of the verb. And that happens in word, verb after verb after verb in English. I've highlighted, so the first problem is transitive verb and intransitive verb. Oh, I'm going to start in motion. I think I will put now, right? No, it doesn't work like that at all. So the definitum is severely under-restricted in standard monolingual English dictionaries. I've highlighted two other definitions in red. You can see to throw with an overhand pushing motion, which as far as I know is only used in the phrase to put the shot, putting the shot. It's a field sport, I gather, for big strong people. And similarly, to cause, to endure, or suffer something, or something is severely under-restricted, you can't say, you put some, even if you recognize the two argument, you can't say, I've been put to bankruptcy. I was very nearly put to bankruptcy. You can say putting someone to the torture, so there's a phraseological, there's a little phraseological set of normal uses. You might be able to think of some other forms of torture or death that you can put people to, especially if you like that sort of thing. But the phraseology is severely restricted. Merriam-Webster also, now on the online version, give examples of usage which may or may not be amended from a corpus. They are not linked to any particular sense. I can say more about this tomorrow. Merriam-Webster has also produced a Merriam-Webster's Advanced Learner's English Dictionary for students, which I reviewed under the heading Common Sense Arrives in Springfield, Massachusetts. But it's not much common sense. Every innovation is to be found in a pre-existing British Learner's Dictionary. But at least there is an element of common sense there, including putting the modern meaning first, so they no longer tell students that a camera is a small vaulted room or the treasury of the papal curia. There are also, I need to say this, just that there are phrasal verbs in Wallet, in the Merriam-Webster Learner's Dictionary, and there are idioms. Okay, now, part of the problem is that dictionary marketing people want you, God, I know this from years of experience, they want new words, they want interesting words, they want unusual words. So I looked at the Merriam-Webster site and I was offered a word of the day, but all dictionary publishers do this. I was offered talk. A verb which I'm happy to tell you I have lived my whole life as an English speaker without ever missing the absence of tog in my active vocabulary. My teenage son has never been togged out in a tuxedo or anything else. Now, let us turn to the other malignant influence. So dictionaries have done a huge amount of huge amount of damage. I can't stop laughing at Pierce's face. So, Noam Chomsky, who is arguably the greatest living polemicist, asserted that lexicography is mere butterfly collecting. And you can see how you would have got that impression from words like tog. Chomsky also referred in 1972 to Saussurean structuralism as an impoverished and thoroughly inadequate conception of language. I'm tempted to retort that introspection-based and tactocentric linguistic theory, by which I mean Chomsky, which has little that is useful or true to say about words and meanings, can be described as an impoverished and thoroughly inadequate conception of language, and yet this is the orthodoxy in many great universities. This is the orthodoxy from which you cannot escape, and unless you define yourself in relation to this dogma, you won't get a job. So, last two slides. Firstly, I think we have to consider the user much more aggressively. We need to focus on what we should do, what we should be telling the users exactly what Rufus just said. We must enable the user to retrieve the information that he or she needs. And to do this, I think studies of words meanings need to be evidence-based, not introspection-based, and probabilistic, not aiming at all and only anything. All and only is a very bad phrase. Probable is... and dictionary users... dictionary users need dictionaries that tell them how to distinguish one of the many senses listed under put. How do you tell one sense from another? And the dictionaries, none of them, not even Cobell, which tried a little bit, none of them do that systematically or efficiently. It's a difficult problem, so we all run away from it. Okay, I am now going to close by saying that we must firstly abandon Leibniz and Descartes for the study of language, not for the study of logic, obviously, but we have to get the relationships, we have to re-examine the relationship between logic and natural language. So to do this, we need to study Wittgenstein and, I suggest, Putnam's work, which is was developed at about the same time as Eleanor Roche's theory of cognitive prototypes. I recommend Dirk, I can't pronounce his name, is it Herrhardt? Thank you. But anyway, you see what I mean. Syntax needs to be put in its place. It should not have a central role in the study of language. It should have the role analogous to the study of glue in carpentry. It's the glue by which you put the words together to make meanings. We should, above all, associate meanings with phraseology and stop isolating words, because that's where the rock set in with put and the whole of the standard corpus of English language dictionaries. And we need to map the phraseological preferences, the patterns, the prototypical or stereotypical patterns onto cognitive prototypes of the kind referred to by Eleanor Roche. Put the whole thing into a Griseian context. I haven't got enough time to tell you about the Griseian context, but get me in the bar afterwards and I will. We have to record the phraseological preferences of each meaning, of each word, and then we have chances of building dictionaries, including monolingual dictionaries, because I should say that it is certainly true that bilingual dictionaries, thank you Robert, go a long way down this road to associating meanings with phraseology rather than with isolating words. So isolationism is also part of the problem. Thank you.